Let's talk for a little bit about complex numbers. Now, complex numbers are a topic that can allow us to deal with something that we might not necessarily every day come across, but there's something that we can't get away from if we're going to be solving quadratics and finding all of the real solutions, because when we find those real solutions, what we're going to inevitably come across is some imaginary solutions. Okay, so let's take, for example, this equation, x squared plus 1 equals 0. Well, if we were to solve this equation, we'd end up with x squared equals minus 1 and if we took the square root of both sides, we'd end up with x is equal to the square root of negative 1. Well, in this case, we've never really dealt with this before. And so this is kind of a problem where, what does that mean? Okay, because, you know, 1 times 1 equals 1, and negative 1 times negative 1 equals 1. So what is the square root of negative 1? And in this case, what we're looking at is the square root of negative 1 is equal to I, the imaginary unit I. And so this is going to help us deal with these square roots that have negatives underneath them. The imaginary unit I. Okay? And so complex numbers are going to be something that we discuss when we have both kinds of parts. So we're going to have real and imaginary parts. Okay, so we have real and imaginary parts. For example, when we look at this, it's something like this. So a complex number example would be A plus B times I. So, for example, this here, this could be like 3 plus 2i. Well, what we have there is this real part, which is the 3, and the imaginary part, which is the 2i. And so it's not that difficult to kind of wrap our head around the fact that we have this real part, because we understand 3, but 2i would be 2 times the square root of negative 1. And so we're still going to be working with, and this is the real part, we're still going to be working with square roots and reducing them, but what we're going to end up with is an I at the end. And this is known as standard form. And the standard form is where we have the real part plus b times, or a coefficient times, the imaginary part. Okay, so let's imagine this for a minute. If b is equal to 0, so a plus bi would be equal to a plus 0i, so it would just be equal to a. That would just be a real number. Okay, so if the coefficient b is 0, then we're going to end up with a real number. If a equals 0, then a plus bi is going to be equal to 0 plus bi, which is equal to bi. This is going to be called a pure imaginary number. So it's not a complex number, because it doesn't have both parts. Complex means both parts. So you can think about it like this. We have real numbers, and we have imaginary. And if we take both of those realms and we put them together, we get a complex number. Okay, so both parts together give us a complex number. All right, so that's the basic gist of it. When we look at standard form, it just helps us sort out the real and the imaginary parts. And what I want to do is, I want to take an example, let's say 4 plus the square root of negative 9. And we're going to have another example here that's 2 minus the square root of negative 27. And we're going to write these numbers in standard form. Well, standard form, we want an a plus a bi. Well, notice we've got these unstandard kind of parts here in negative 9 and negative 27. And so what we're going to do is we're going to learn to deal with that. So I'm just going to go ahead and take out the square root of negative 1. Because I remember that underneath the square root, multiplying can give me that number underneath. And so what's going to look like is this, because I know that the square root of negative 1 is I. And so this looks kind of funny because it's not exactly standard yet. And so I'm going to rewrite a little bit. So I'm going to have 4 plus, and the square root of 9 is going to be 3, and then I'm left with that I part. So this is actually my answer. So I evaluate the square root as far as I can and simplify it as much as I can, and then leave that I part out front. If you want to go ahead and pause the video right now and try this example, I'm going to do it after the break. So just go ahead and pause, and you can see if you can do this on your own, and then check your answer. As I simplify this, I am going to pull out a root of negative 1 and leave this as 27, and so I'm going to have 2 minus I root 27. And over to the side here, this might be a good strategy for you. Work on breaking this up. And when I bring it back over this way, I'm going to have 2 minus I times 3, which is the square root of 9, and then square root of 3. So as I rewrite, 2 minus 3i square root 3. Okay, so we can write it in that form, and that's my final answer. So hopefully you got that one when you paused. Okay, so that's that part. Adding and subtracting complex numbers. Let's just look at an example here. Let's say I've got 4i or 4 plus 7i, and I'm adding that to 1 minus 6i. Well, really what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my real parts and I'm going to add those together. So I've got 5. And then I'm going to take my imaginary parts, understanding, of course, that the coefficient on the first one is 7 and the first coefficient on the second part is negative 6. So I'm going to have plus, and then 7 plus a minus 6i would be just I. So I add the parts that are alike. So in this case, the real part and the imaginary part. Subtracting works much the same way. So if I have 1 plus 2i, and now notice these are in parentheses because it's just telling us, hey, these are complex numbers and they go together. So if I've got something like this, I've got to remember that this negative sign is getting distributed into both parts. So if I rewrite, it sometimes helps me to rewrite it as an addition problem. And so then I'm adding the opposite of both of those things. And so as I work on this, I'm going to add the real parts. So that's going to give me minus 3. And a 2i plus a negative 2i would be plus 0i. So in this case, I just end up with a real number, and that's okay. That can happen when you add and subtract complex numbers. So that's adding and subtracting. We can also do other operations with them, such as multiply. And when we multiply, everything is the same, meaning all of the rules still apply. I can still use the distributive property. I can still FOIL them, can do any of these operations. So we're going to do two examples here. And as we look at them, just know that it's as if we've got an x, so it's that I is it functions in the same way as a variable. It stands for another thing. And so as we multiply, we're going to work with the coefficients primarily. So I've got 4 times negative 2 plus 4 times 3i. All I need to do is simplify now. So I've got negative 8 plus 12i. That's all there is to it. So I can distribute them. Using the FOIL method, So I've got 2 times 4 plus 2 times 3i. And there's a little bit of a trick to this, and I'll show you here in just a minute. So I need to keep my negative sign straight there. And then I've got minus, and now I've got I times 3i. Well, let's simplify everything here first before we deal with that I squared at the back. So I've got 8 plus 6i minus 4i minus 3i squared. And so I've got 8 plus 2i minus 3i squared. So let's do a little bit of an aside here. I is equal to the square root of negative 1. And so I squared is going to be equal to, let me clean that up a little bit. I squared is equal to the negative, or the square root of negative 1 squared. And so really, those are going to cancel out. And so I squared is really equal to negative 1. If I use that here, I really come up with a number on the end. And this is pretty cool because later we're going to learn how to use this to try to figure out fractions and to, you know, simplify the denominators and rationalize the denominators. So really this becomes plus 3. So I really have 11 plus 2i as my answer. So that last term with the I squared actually goes away from being an imaginary number, and it becomes comes into the realm of real because I squared that I. All right, so let's talk about complex conjugate for a second. Complex conjugates are where I take a complex number. So I'm taking this number, a plus bi, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to find the complex conjugate. And as I find the complex conjugate, all I have to do is switch the sign in the middle. So I'm going to have a minus bi. You wouldn't necessarily know to do this, but I'm going to show you why we use complex conjugate. Because if I multiply complex conjugates together, take a look here for a minute. As I do this, and I distribute using the FOIL method, so I've got the first, so a squared, which is a real number, and then I've got minus a times bi. And then this middle term is plus a times bi. And the last term is going to be minus b squared I squared. That's a huge part of this. Because as I look at this now, these two middle terms are going to cancel out. Because plus abi minus abi cancel out. And so I'm left with a squared, which is a real number. And then over here, I'm going to remember that I squared is really a negative 1. Well, this is huge because now I have minus b squared, b is a real number, times negative 1. Where did all the i's go? They're gone. That's why we want to do this, because as we work on this complex conjugate, we end up with a case where I don't have any imaginary parts anymore. This is a real number. And this is really good, because if I have a complex number in the denominator, I can now eliminate the complex part in the denominator. And so let's take a look here. If we're multiplying by complex conjugates, actually let's just skip to using the complex conjugate. Now what I'm left with is using this. You kind of figured out what it was. And if I'm given a fraction like this, it looks pretty crazy because I've got these i's. And really, this is the square root of negative 1. So I want to, basically what I'm doing is I'm rationalizing the denominator. So I'm going to multiply by the complex conjugate. Complex conjugate. So we're going to multiply by the complex conjugate. Now I didn't write it very well here, but conjugate. There we go. And as we multiply by the complex conjugate, you're going to see exactly what happens. And so let me rewrite the problem to clean it up. And just as in the previous slide, we saw what happens. Some things are going to cancel out. And really, I've got to use the complex conjugate of the denominator. And so I'm going to multiply by 4 plus 2i over 4 plus 2i. Now, this is not an equation, so I'm not multiplying by both sides. Really, essentially what I'm doing is I'm multiplying by 1 because the numerator and denominator are the same. And so as I do this, I'm not changing the value of this fraction. I'm just rewriting it in terms of a different denominator. So as I multiply, 2 times 4 is 8. 2 times 2i is 4i. 3i times 4 would be 12i. And 3 times 2i would be 6i squared. On the bottom, I'm going to end up with 16 plus 8i minus 8i. Now that's a huge step because as you can see, those are going to cancel out. And then I've got minus 4i squared. As I rewrite, now don't get intimidated because I've got some things to rewrite here. So on top, I'm going to have 8 plus 16i plus 6 times negative 1. And on the bottom, I'm going to have 16, these two cancel, minus 4 times negative 1 because that I squared is negative 1. Let's continue to rewrite. So on top, I've got 2 because negative 6 plus 8 would be 2, plus 16i. And on bottom, I've got 16 plus 4 is 20. I still have to simplify because I've got a factor of 2. So what I can do is I can write it as 1 plus 8i over 10. And even now, I still have a factor of 2 in here and a factor of 2 in here, so I'll split the numerator, plus 4i over 5. And that is my answer to this problem. Okay? And so that's a way that we can do this to give us no i's in the denominator. Look at my denominator. No i's in the denominator. This is good. It's like rationalizing the denominator. Let's do one more. Complex solutions, and we're going to work on this equation here. 3x squared minus 2x plus 5 equals 0. Now, I can't really factor this because there's nothing that multiplies to 5 to give me negative 2 that adds to negative 2. And so as I'm looking at this, I have to, I'm going to have to use the quadratic formula. So x is equal to negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4 times a times c. And that's all going to be over 2a. So as I do this, I'm going to go minus a minus 2 plus or minus the square root of negative 2 squared minus 4 times 3 times 5 all over 2 times 3. As I rewrite, I've got 2 plus or minus the square root of. Now this is 4 minus, and I've got 4 times 3 is 12, times 5 would be 60 over 6. A little bit of rewriting here. 2 plus or minus the square root of negative 56. And this is where my I is going to come in handy. Because now I can rewrite this as 2 plus or minus the square root of negative 1, square root of 56. And this root of 56, I'm going to hop up here real quick. I am going to split that. And I'll use square root of 4 and square root of 14. That's definitely 16, 14. And so this is going to be 2 root 14 would be square root of 56. And so as I rewrite one more time, 2 plus or minus 2 I root 14 over 6. And so the 2i came from here and this negative 1. Okay, so that's where all that came from. So I took the negative 1 as I and then 2 root 14. And I've got to simplify because I have a factor of 2 in all of them. So I'm going to have 1 third, which is 2 over 6, plus or minus root 14 over 3. And let me erase some of this so that it's clearer to you. Root 14 over 3, or I could rewrite it as 1 plus or minus root 14 over 3. Okay, so that's how we use complex numbers with the quadratic formula to solve quadratics. Okay, thanks for watching this, guys. I really appreciate it, and we'll see you next time.